Hey everyone, many of us will have started off using Wi-Fi to connect our devices to the internet, but at some point we might have experienced unreliable or slow connections, and so we bought an Ethernet cable and a cheap unmanaged switch and hooked it all up. But if we ever want to move above gigabit networking to achieve 10 gig, 25 gig, or even 100 gigabit networking, you'll quickly find that copper Ethernet cables just don't cut it anymore. And there's actually an entire world of non-copper related networking cables and equipment out there. So it's probably no secret that some form of fiber is used for higher speed networks, but why won't standard Ethernet cables like this actually cut it anymore at higher speeds? Is copper the problem, since Ethernet cables are copper-based after all? Well, that's the interesting thing. There's actually been various research and tests done that actually prove that copper cables can actually be faster than fiber optic cables, in some cases. Research from Arista, which I'll link to down in the description, actually shows that copper can have lower latency than fiber, especially at shorter distances. So why is copper-based Ethernet considered too slow for 10 gigabit and above networking speeds? Well, that research actually looks at DAC, Direct Attach Copper, that uses a special form of copper-based cable to transmit internet data over shorter distances. I'll come back to DAC later. But Ethernet cables are different. Even the latest higher quality Cat7 cables still ultimately use thinner wires than found in DAC. Plus, Ethernet cables have RJ45 connectors at both ends. If you simply look at an RJ45 connector, you can kind of tell that it's inherently limited. It doesn't have much room to actually terminate the 8 really small cables, and so crosstalk will always be an issue as networking speeds start to increase, especially if we talk in over 100 gigabit speeds, for example. The small design will also mean that EMI, electromagnetic interference, could also be more of an issue here. Finally, copper is just generally flawed as a method for longer distance data transfer. The signal will get weaker and weaker the further the cable is actually run, which is known as attenuation. Both Ethernet and DAC will work well at shorter distances, but will struggle at longer distances. So if you're planning to fit high-speed networking throughout an office block, Ethernet just won't cut it as a viable option. That's where fiber cables come in. They transmit data through pulses of light that bounce through the thin glass strand that actually runs throughout the entire fiber optic cable. Because light moves very quickly, fiber can actually be a quick way of moving internet-based traffic from one source to another, such as from an internet street cabinet into someone's home, which we call FTTP in the UK, or from a private internet carrier to some big data center, for example. Because they are non-metallic, fiber optic cables are also immune from electromagnetic and radio interference, and while attenuation is always inevitable, there's much less signal drop-off with fiber cables than with copper-based cabling like Ethernet or DAC. As a result, fiber optic cables are the perfect choice for a backbone of a network. But it does have some flaws too. Fiber is often more expensive than copper cables, and it's also a bit more brittle. Plus, people's computers don't actually have fiber ports in general, meaning that there often needs to be a conversion from fiber to Ethernet somewhere along the networking line, which introduces a little bit of latency. So I'll discuss how 10 gigabit and beyond networking speeds is actually achieved in a minute, but firstly I wanted to back up and discuss DAC more, because I kind of mentioned that at the very start of this video and then just stopped talking about it. Direct attach copper uses thicker, higher quality copper than Ethernet, and also the cables and the connectors are designed in such a way that there is less crosstalk and signal degradation than with Ethernet. Plus, remember I said that fiber will need to be converted somewhere along the line? Well, with DAC, it's already copper-based, so there's no need to then have the electrical copper to optical conversion, leading to lower latencies compared to fiber optic cables. What this all means is that for a typical household, it can be ideal to run DAC everywhere, because while DAC is limited to 50 meters or so at 10 gigabit speeds, it's unlikely this will be exceeded in a home environment, especially if you're just running a cable from downstairs to upstairs, or from one room to another. However, it certainly won't be possible to use this for transferring loads of internet traffic from one part of a city to another. So now we come to how 10 gigabit networking is often achieved. I actually recently upgraded my study, I'm sat in now, to 10 gigabit, and I used Ethernet for this, which I'll show off in another video. And I actually kind of regret that choice now, because whilst you can use Ethernet for 10 gig speeds, which is known as 10G base T, it's often not advised. Copper Ethernet just runs hot at 10 gigabit speeds. My Ubiquiti 10 gig switch is constantly warm to touch, and the whole setup consumes a fair bit more power than it would have if I'd simply gone with a DAC or fiber optic based approach. A great post on the TrueNAS forums, which I'll also link to down in the description, mentions the Ethernet can use as much as 10 times as much power than SFP plus will. Plus 10 gig Ethernet switches are much more expensive than SFP plus switches. So all in all, if you want to achieve 10 gigabit networking, either at home or in an office environment, you'd probably be better off with an SFP plus based solution. And yes, I realize that I've just said SFP plus three times, but I haven't yet discussed what this is. So SFP plus is a type of connector, meaning this arrival for RJ45. While many of the network switches you're used to actually accept RJ45, when we're dealing with high-speed networks, you'll start seeing SFP ports instead. SFP plus is rated for 10 gigabit speeds, and it's the most typical way that 10 gigabit networking is achieved. So basically, you'd have an SFP plus switch, and your key machines like your servers or workstation PCs would also have an SFP plus network card via the PCI Express slot. So you could then run SFP plus cables all around your house, right? No. There's actually no such thing as an SFP plus cable. It would be a bit like saying an RJ45 cable. You probably mean Ethernet, but it's not quite saying the same thing. In this context, when people discuss SFP plus cable, they often mean DAC, actually, because direct attached copper cables usually come with an SFP plus connector pre-fitted to it, meaning that you can easily buy DAC and easily hook it up to your switches and networking cards, delivering fast, reliable, low power and low latency 10 gigabit networking, which is great. But that's not the only way of actually getting SFP plus. You can buy transceivers that allow you to plug a cable into them, and then this converts the cable to SFP plus, and you can then plug this into the networking switch. And at 10 gigabit speeds, you can actually buy Ethernet transceivers, meaning that you can convert a Cat7 cable to have an SFP plus connection, for example. The only downside here is that, again, Ethernet runs very hot at 10 gigabit speeds, and it continues to be power hungry too. Simply plugging it into an SFP plus transceiver doesn't suddenly redeem Ethernet at these high speeds, unfortunately. So the way that network engineers would usually achieve 10 gigabit networking is by running a mix of fiber optic and DAC around a home, office, or building. And they'd mainly use SFP plus switches and other networking gear, using transceivers as needed. But when it comes to standard end user machines, a conversion is still needed, right? I mean, we can't just install SFP plus cards into everyone's computer. That's why you often see higher speed Ethernet switches that have one or two SFP plus ports. These are designed to take a higher speed fiber or DAC connection, and then the other ports are often 1 gigabit or 2.5 gigabit Ethernet, where you would then run a standard copper RJ45 cable, Ethernet cable to the end user machines as normal, and also to a Wi-Fi router for devices to then connect wirelessly in the normal way, of course. So coming back to the title of this video, it's not 100% true to say that the network pros simply never use Ethernet, of course, because it's used at some point along the line, but certainly not the central pivotal backbone for high-speed networks, to be honest. So that's awesome. That's how the pros would do it. Within a building, like a school, home, or office, or something like that. But what about moving internet data from one building to another, or across an entire city? Well, major ISPs would deal with at least 100 gigabit backlinks, but some smaller organizations might only work with 10 gigabit. We know that copper-based solutions are out for this due to attenuation problems, so that leaves fiber. And in general, there's two types of fiber delivery that we need to know about here. Multi-mode fiber, MMF, and single-mode fiber, SMF. SMF cables have a fairly narrow core that only allows a single light mode through, whereas, as its name suggests, MMF supports multiple light modes due to its wider core. Logically, you'd think this means that MMF is better, and, well, it is faster, but also has more light dispersion due to the core design of it. And as a result, MMF is often used for shorter distances, within buildings itself, or maybe from one office building to a neighbouring office building, but up to around 300 metres, no more. Whereas SSF is best for transmitting internet data from one city to another, or one part of the city to another, for example. Once the cable run is complete, the only real difference would be the transceiver used. SSF needs 10G base SR transceivers, where SR stands for short range, whereas MMF needs 10G base LR, or sometimes ER, extended range. So everyone has 10 gigabit networking and we can relax and go home, right? Well, no, because obviously some organizations will need more than this. 25 gigabit and 100 gigabit networks are the most common that you would often see beyond the 10 gigabit level. To be honest though, everything is kind of the same here, but just at a much different scale. Costs start to go up massively with data center switches being needed throughout the entire network deployment, the network stack, and these often aren't cheap. For example, a used Arista 7060CX switch, which supports 100 gig speeds, costs over £2,000 here in the UK. It also needs two 745 watt power supplies to handle the massive power load that it will inevitably need. Although it's worth pointing out that one of these is for redundancy, the device only uses a mere 745 watts. You also need SFP plugs the majority of the time, but we've moved on from 10GB SFP Plus transceivers to SFP 28 and Q SFP 28 for the 100Gb. You can also get SFP 28 and Q SFP 28 DAC cables for shorter runs of 3 to 5 meters, but it can't support longer distances than this due to the limitations of copper that we discussed earlier. So a network engineer at these higher networking requirements would still typically run fiber around a building, especially for these longer runs, using 25G base or 100G base transceivers as needed to connect to SFP ports on servers and switches, but they also sometimes use DAC for very short runs. I find it pretty interesting actually just how home networking moves away from Ethernet cables beyond 1 or 2.5 gig speeds, but it kind of makes sense actually. I had various issues when trying to upgrade just this study to 10 gigabit speeds, as I show off in this other video if you wanted to check that out, and I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please click the thumbs up button and please subscribe to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching.